Has Peyton talked at all about the horror of that moment?
She wasn't supposed to make it out alive.
Tonight on 2020, Out of the Woods.
Slenderman.
The stunning new interrogation tapes never seen before until this week. 12-year-old girls describing why they lured their friend into the woods and stabbed her 19 times.
I might as well just say it. We were trying to kill her.
Tonight, we take you inside the Slenderman hearings just this week. What we've never heard before in their own words, their own voices.
I'm saying, dear God, this is really happening.
They say all of it to impress a fictional character on the internet called Slenderman.
Stab.
The stunning apology in the woods to their friend.
I said I'm sorry. This had to happen.
How do you even wrap your heads around that?
Plus, the big shocking reveal. Was it the biggest red flag of all for parents everywhere? What was discovered on their computers, their cell phones? David Muir's exclusive journey with the family of that little girl, the survivor. And tonight, what we've just learned about her, the milestone just this past week.
We knew that she had the strength, but now I think everybody knows it.
Everybody does know.
Out of the Woods. Here now, David Muir and Elizabeth Vargas.
Good evening. Tonight, the heartbreaking and horrifying new evidence in a case we've been following for months. For the first time, we're hearing those interrogation tapes, 12-year-old girls calmly describing why they lured one of their best friends into the woods, stabbing her 19 times and leaving her to die. All of it, they say, for Slender Man. And David, you spent a lot of time with that little survivor.
We've been following this journey, as you know, Elizabeth, a brave journey, and no one could have imagined what we would hear in these interrogations revealed in court just this week. A country, a community, now reliving the horror, stunned that those two girls could explain in such a matter-of-fact way why they did this.
Tonight, like much of this country, it is a snowy and frigid Friday night in one American town, Waukesha, Wisconsin, where this evening, an entire community is stunned all over again after hearing this week, for the first time from two girls, their own voices, about the night they allegedly lured their friend into the woods and repeatedly stabbed her, police say, leaving her to die.
She handed me the knife and told me to stab her.
2020 has been following the case every step of the way. It's a horror story that began more than 8 months ago. A mother and father, like so many parents across this country, sending their daughter on a sleepover. At the time, Peyton Lightner was just 12, and her parents knew her friend well, Morgan Geiser and another 12-year-old, all of them celebrating Morgan's birthday. Why would this night be any different? But it was.
On Saturday, May 31st, 2014, a 12-year-old girl was stabbed.
Tonight, the explosive new interrogation tapes just released. As we take you back inside a case that horrified parents across this country.
Two 12-year-old girls charged with viciously attacking their friend.
They stabbed their friend 19 times.
Those girls, the suspects, in their own words, in the hours after they were taken into custody. It is the first time we hear from Morgan Geiser talking about her friend Peyton, who they left in the woods.
She was my only friend for a long time.
Why would you hurt your only friend?
It was necessary.
And for the first time, we also hear from Anissa Wire, too. Her face blurred, the judge releasing this footage with the requirement not to show their faces during the interrogations.
I said, I'm scared. I was told that if I didn't do something, my family would be in danger.
Her family in danger? Who and what were those girls so scared of? We explore that right here tonight. While parents everywhere might be saying, not my child, tonight, you're about to hear how all of this began as an ordinary slumber party. Three girls and someone else. An unknown figure getting into that party too. A fictional character from the internet named Slenderman, who so many parents had never even heard of. We have spent months in that town and have documented one family's journey. Two parents helping their daughter recover.
She was forced to go into the woods.
From the hero who found her at the edge of the woods.
She was laying right here.
The doctors who saw how close to death she came.
The knife cut through the tissue.
And the school where Peyton has now returned. One family's stunning journey about to play out tonight right before your eyes. And just this week, two parents who heard for the first time from the friends who police say attacked their daughter.
It was a Friday night, right?
It was a Friday night.
Their daughter Peyton had been looking forward to it for weeks.
You remember how excited she was that Friday
afternoon? Oh my gosh, she was so, so excited.
And had she gone on sleepovers before?
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. And this was just a, you know, her best friend's birthday party.
It was just another Friday night.
So she was gonna go roller skating, have some pizza, and spend the night at her best friend's house.
Yeah, they were probably gonna watch movies.
And so you thought this
and play American Girl. Peyton brought her American Girl doll with her.
She brought her American Girl.
But Peyton would not come home the next morning.
Do you think Peyton had any idea?
No. She had absolutely no idea.
She was blindsided.
Her parents blindsided too. Friday night, they send their daughter off. Saturday morning, mom is in the backyard.
Joe was at work. I heard the doorbell ring and the dog bark. And it was a Saturday morning at like 9:45. And around the side of the house up over the deck came a uniformed officer. The first thing that goes through my mind is, so something has happened to somebody that I love, because that's the only reason a uniformed officer and a detective comes to your house on a Saturday morning.
She would slowly begin to piece together what had happened in the 16 hours since Peyton had left for that sleepover. It is unthinkable. The first moment anyone would begin to learn of that horror was this call to 911.
911, I'm transferring over a caller on Big Bend.
After she crawled out of the woods. And just listen, at first, the operators cannot believe what they are hearing.
Came upon a 12-year-old female. She appears to be stabbed.
She appears to be what?
Stabbed.
Stabbed?
Correct.
Greg Steinberg was riding his bike that morning on a path that had actually been chained off. It was pure chance that he came this way.
Sir, are you with her right now?
Yes.
Is she awake?
She's awake.
Is there any bleeding going on?
Her clothing has got blood on it.
Okay, and you found her and she was just laying there?
Yeah.
On that call, you can actually hear Greg comforting Peyton.
Somebody's coming. Who did that to you?
And you were biking by and she says to you what?
Could you help me, please? I've been stabbed multiple times. I quick got out my cell phone. I was shaking and dialed 911. I just stayed with the 911 operator and I offered her water because I had a water bottle on my bike. The other thing she said was she's having trouble breathing.
And she's right here laying on the grass.
He watches as the ambulance rushes her away, the hospital less than 4 miles away from that path.
And when you looked at her, it was immediately apparent she'd been stabbed multiple times.
Yeah, to her chest and abdomen and arm and leg.
Doctors concerned she might not survive, and her mother, Stacy, has just been told Peyton has been rushed to the hospital. She's also been told it was her best friend, Morgan, who did this. She calls her husband.
And I said, Peyton's been stabbed. Morgan stabbed Peyton. You need to come home. They need to rush Peyton into surgery. So then I really lost it.
So you got in the car?
Got in the car.
Minutes later, arriving.
So I walked into the trauma room that she was in, and she was pale as a ghost. She was terrified. She was crying. She couldn't breathe.
But she saw you there.
She saw me, and she put her hand out, and I rushed over to her, and I put my arms around her, and I laid next to her, and I hugged her, and I said, you're going to be okay. It's going to be fine. But I could see that she was covered. Her arms and her legs and her abdomen, they were covered in stab wounds.
They pull her away from her daughter, and she can soon hear the nurses counting.
And all I hear is, there's five on her arm, there's seven on her leg, and I'm thinking, what, seven? What? And one of the nurses says, all right, I count 19. And then the second nurse said, I count 19 as well. 19? What? There's no way.
There were so many stab wounds, it took two nurses to count them. 19 in all. And her little girl is now being raced down the hall.
Because then they took her into surgery. Did you say anything to Peyton as they were wheeling her away?
That I loved her and that she would be okay.
But there was something else Peyton's mother was thinking at the same time.
Morgan didn't do this, is what's going through my head. There's no way. There's no way that's what happened. Morgan is 12.
But that's exactly what investigators believe, that Morgan and the only other girl who was invited to that sleepover, Anissa Wire, did this. But they were nowhere to be found.
They had run away and the police hadn't found them yet. And we just knew that Peyton told us Morgan stabbed her and the police hadn't been able to find the girls.
And in fact, police believe those girls were walking
Yeah.
And tonight, right here, we finally hear from the detectives, the investigators, who searched for those girls, who found them. Detective Michelle Trussoni on the stand just this week.
And once they left that wooded area, they started walking. They could hear the sirens coming.
They were going to find a mansion in the woods.
Oh, the mansion, yeah, the mansion in the woods. They were going to the Nicolet Forest because they believed that there was a mansion there that Slenderman lived in.
And this week, we heard the interrogation. Just listen to Morgan, her own voice, her own words, acknowledging who they were looking for.
We tried to find Slenderman.
Trying to find who?
Slender.
Who's Slenderman?
He's this tall, faceless man who preys on children.
A character named Slenderman, who police say they were hoping to impress, all while their 12-year-old friend Peyton is in the OR fighting off death. When we come back, the doctors who discover it is worse than anyone thought. We're with the surgeon who saves her.
Less than a millimeter.
Between living and dying.
Yes.
Tonight, you'll hear much more from them in their own words. The hours of interrogation tapes just revealed. Why did they do this? What was discovered on their computers, their cell phones? And later tonight, right here, our time with the survivor, Peyton, and a brand new milestone 1 week ago tonight. A young girl you will never forget.
'20 continues with Out of the Woods. Once again, David Muir.
Waukesha, Wisconsin, just outside Milwaukee. Tonight, in the depths of a brutal winter blast, they're also dealing with something else. The gruesome new details emerging just this week about a horrific tale that began to play out on a Saturday morning this past May. A birthday sleepover with three 12-year-olds the night before. And now two girls are missing. The other, Peyton Leichner, has somehow crawled out of the woods, covered in stab wounds, 19 of them. She is wheeled into the operating room. And just this week, more than 8 months after that moment, the pretrial hearing. And we're now hearing from the detectives who tried to talk to her the moment she was brought in.
It seemed that it hurt too much for her to talk. She had a hard time breathing.
Outside that hospital, in that town,
a major search by ground.
These are the woods where the stabbing
police are still on the scene here.
A frantic search for the two missing, Morgan Geiser and Anissa Wire.
Two 12-year-old girls stabbing their friend nearly to death is unimaginable any time, but especially for a safe community like the city of Waukesha.
So unimaginable that even the brother of one of those missing girls at first confused, fearing for her safety too. Showing reporters photos of his sister, asking, have you seen her?
That's her, that's Anissa. She's been missing for I don't know how long now.
While back at the hospital, where they ask us to put on scrubs to enter the OR, the surgeon, John Kellerman, is about to discover just how much damage has been done. He tells me about one of the stab wounds to the heart.
The knife came directly down at this point where this large branch was coming off of this major artery and cut through the tissue overlying it so that the vessels were totally exposed by this injury.
The knife cut through the tissue, but not the artery itself.
Exactly. The knife stopped at the wall of the artery.
And had it not?
Had it not, she would have had a major heart attack from the amount of bleeding and probably died within a minute or two.
That close to death, but they were now saving her life. While the hunt for the other two girls is in high gear, every agency in the area searching.
We had the Waukesha County Sheriff's Department, the City of Waukesha Police Department, New Berlin Police Department, City of Waukesha Fire Department, and Flight for Life all scouring that area.
Then, nearly 5 hours after Peyton crawled out of those woods, the two other girls are found. They were right here along Interstate 94 heading out of Waukesha. A knife with a 5-inch blade found in one of the girls' bags. And just this week in court, we heard from the officer describing Anissa Wire the moment she was taken into custody.
I asked her to show me her hands, and she complied. And then I asked her to walk towards my voice. I noticed there was some staining on her sweatshirt around the abdomen area.
And Anissa, in her own words, describing the moment she was found.
I said, I'm scared. I was told that if I didn't do something, my family would be in danger.
Neither girl puts up a fight. They would soon be questioned, And we now hear Morgan describing the victim, Peyton, as one of her closest friends.
She was my best friend since fourth grade.
Who was?
Peyton.
So why did you pick Peyton?
I didn't pick her.
And as Morgan is being questioned, that friend Peyton is coming out of surgery.
And when that surgeon comes out, what did he reveal?
He said, so we had to crack her chest. It was awful to hear that she had to go through that.
How close do you think she was to losing her?
If the knife had gone the width of a human hair further, she wouldn't have lived.
A human hair. What is that, a millimeter?
Less than a millimeter.
Between living and dying?
Yes.
Where on earth do you think she got the strength to crawl out of those woods?
Well, we asked her, and she said, I wanted to live.
At first, Peyton couldn't talk, writing to communicate.
Do you remember the first message she wrote?
I want to go home.
I want to go home.
When can I go home?
And has Peyton talked at all about the horror of that moment?
She told me she was scared. But the first time I asked her what she remembered about what happened, she said, all I remember is the pain.
The pain.
And they would reveal to me there was something else she asked.
Did they get them? We told her they were found and the police have them.
And as a dad in that moment, how hard was that?
Harder than I would have ever been able to imagine. This is my little girl who's laying there, and the only thing that I could tell her at the time to make her feel better was that the police have them and she was safe with us.
His daughter, terrified of the two girls who were her friends.
How well did you know these two other girls?
They were best friends
since about fourth grade.
Fourth grade is when we met Morgan for the first time.
They say Peyton would talk to Morgan every night on the phone.
Were there ever any red flags?
They would have little arguments, but every 12-year-old girl has little arguments.
The other 12-year-old, Anissa Weyer, they had not met, but they say Peyton knew her from school. And as Joe and Stacy reassure their daughter that the girls had been found, police were questioning them. What did they do to their friend? And even more disturbing, why did they do it? Tonight, Morgan, for the first time in those interrogation tapes, seeming to waver.
I didn't want to do this.
Why did you do it then?
I was afraid of what would happen if I didn't.
And Anissa, also fearing what would happen if they didn't do it.
I was really scared, knowing that Slytherin could easily kill my whole family in 3 seconds.
And just listen to the detective who was questioning her.
When Morgan said to you that if we don't do this for Slytherin, our families and loved ones are going to be killed, do you honestly believe that?
When we come back, the bone-chilling plan emerges.
They're going to put duct tape over her mouth.
The plan was to murder her. She wasn't supposed to make it out alive.
They told police they wanted to kill the victim so people would know that Slender Man was real.
Who is this mysterious fictional character born on the internet? As we hear from those girls now in their own words about what it was that drove them to do this. And we see the alarming images found from inside one of the girls' bedrooms. Right near the dolls, the bed, the clothes, there was something else.
Out of the Woods continues. Once again, David Muir.
As 12-year-old Peyton Leitner recovers from surgery in her hospital bed, she is still unable to talk, writing messages to her parents instead, asking, did they get them? While across town at the Waukesha Police Department, they had. The two other friends at that sleepover now answering questions of their own. And those newly released interrogation tapes allow an entire community tonight to now hear how matter-of-fact Morgan sounded in describing the moment to the detective.
What were you trying to do with her when you stabbed her?
Kill her. I might as well just say it. We were trying to kill her.
Ellen Gabler is a reporter at the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel. She has followed the case closely.
You can't believe this is actually 12-year-olds, especially 12-year-old girls.
They tell police they committed this crime in part out of their devotion to that character, Slender Man.
Who's Slender Man?
He's this tall, faceless man who preys on children.
You ever met him?
Not exactly.
Tell me about him.
He watches you.
Anissa and her description.
He could be anywhere from 6 feet to 14 feet tall. He doesn't have a face. His skin is white. And at his own will, he can explode these tendrils from his back and strangle his victims.
The online story of Slenderman changing, evolving all the time, with help from fans all over the world, adding to the story, giving this fictional character new life every day.
You have said that Slenderman is the boogeyman of this digital generation.
He is the thing that we fear that we don't actually encounter, right? So we check under our beds for the Slenderman, but he's, you know, not actually there.
But listen to what these two girls begin to tell police.
Orion said, "Hey, Anissa, we should be proxies." I was like, "Okay, how would we do that?"
She indicated that in order to become a proxy of Slenderman, you needed to kill somebody to prove yourself worthy to him.
Anissa says she was surprised by Morgan's plan, but excited.
I was excited because I wanted proof that he existed, because there were a bunch of skeptics out there saying that he didn't exist.
And in excruciating detail, they describe multiple plots, all beginning with that Friday night sleepover.
They went to Skateland that night, and they went skating, and they had originally planned to kill their friend that night in Morgan's house.
And tonight, we now hear from the detective about how they would do it.
And the plan was to stab Peyton in the neck, and she would bleed out. They would cover her up with covers to make it look like she was sleeping, and the two girls would run.
But for some reason, at that moment, the girls changed their minds.
She wouldn't be here right now if they had waited until 2 o'clock in the morning and done this overnight. She wouldn't have been found for hours.
So the next morning comes, and they change the plan.
We're going to do it today at the park. That's what Morgan said.
They brought her here to the park on Saturday morning to kill her in this bathroom. Their big concern was finding a drain for the blood to go down, not the fact that they were going to stab and kill somebody.
As they leave Morgan's house for the park, Anissa tells police Morgan lifts up her white jacket, the knife tucked in her waistband.
What were you thinking? I was thinking, dear God, this is really happening.
But once inside that park bathroom, something happens between the girls, now hatching their second plot.
There was a back and forth between Morgan and Anissa about who was going to stab the girl. Both of them chickened out, essentially, and said that they told police they couldn't do it.
But there would be one more plan. The girls leave that bathroom and walk down a nearby road. And it was Peyton's parents who took us there months ago, revealing to me what their little girl told them.
They got to the park and they told her they wanted to play hide and seek in the woods. And she told me she didn't want to go.
She sensed it.
Yeah, she did say she was forced to go.
To play hide and seek.
To come, she was forced to go into the woods.
In fact, the girls tell police about that game of hide and seek.
Anissa and the victim were hiding. Anissa told her to lay down in the dirt and she didn't want to.
Anissa tells police she sits on Peyton and that Peyton says to her, "I can't breathe."
When she tried to sit on her to get her to go onto the ground, Peyton began yelling.
She tells police they both fear Peyton screaming will draw attention. Anissa gets up.
In that moment, they were passing the knife back and forth because they were having second thoughts, even in that moment.
At that point, one girl says to the other, "Just go crazy."
Yeah.
And we discover, hours into those newly released interrogation tapes, Anissa with a stunning description.
Morgan and I were gonna be like lionesses chasing down a zebra. I was gonna tackle her, and then Morgan was gonna do the stabbing.
Anissa tells police Morgan takes the knife, turns to her friend and says, "I'm not going to until you tell me to." Anissa says she then told Morgan to, quote, "go ballistic, go crazy." And from those tapes, here's Morgan's description.
What did you do next?
Stab.
And just listen tonight to what Morgan reveals she said to Peyton.
I said, "I'm sorry. This had to happen." She was like, "Why?" And then I said that it was necessary.
And Anissa describing their friend Peyton on the ground in that moment.
The whole time, Peyton was screaming in agony. saying stuff like, I hate you guys, I'll never forgive you, and I trusted you. Still, and, sorry.
Peyton is stabbed 19 times, stumbling, trying to get up.
The suspects were getting worried that somebody would hear her, and so they told her to lay down, and they said that she wouldn't lose blood as quickly.
The two girls tell police they signaled to Peyton they would get her help. And now we hear this.
Did you want to actually get her help?
No.
I kind of wanted to, but I knew Maureen wouldn't want me to.
They would leave her right there.
And has Peyton talked at all about the horror of that moment?
We asked her what she remembered about what happened, and she said she remembered everything.
Detective Shelley Fisher interviewed Peyton in the hospital.
She said that she was rolling around on the ground, that it was hard for her to breathe, and it was hard for her to see as things were getting blurry.
Her friends at that sleepover asked by police how they felt about what they did. Anissa seemed most torn.
She said, according to police, the bad part of me wanted her to die.
The bad part of me wanted her to die? But the good part of me wanted her to live.
When you hear that?
When I hear that, I hear a girl who was struggling with the decision that they were making. She sensed that it was the wrong decision to be making.
Police say Morgan said, it was weird that I didn't feel remorse.
Yeah.
This was a girl who had been in your home many, many times. That line, it was weird that I didn't feel remorse.
That was hard to read because I thought that she really cared about Peyton as a person and they were good friends.
In court, we've heard Morgan described as a child with problems. But did you see any of that?
Not really, no.
This wasn't a disturbed child you were bringing into your home.
No.
So when we come back, what was it? What set those girls off? Could a fictional character really convince two 12-year-olds to kill?
She said that he'd kill our families. I was really scared, knowing that Slytherin could easily kill my whole family in 3 seconds.
Also new tonight, what was found on their phones, a key text message, and on their computers, what one of them had searched for on the internet. Was it the biggest red flag of them all?
...2020 continues with David Muir.
Tonight, with those newly released interrogation tapes, much of the world is hearing this name again.
Slender Man.
The Slender Man stabbing case.
They did it to impress Slender Man.
Who is the shadowy figure?
Slender Man.
Slender Man.
Slender Man.
The mysterious fictional character online that few parents had ever heard of. But on those interrogation tapes tonight, it is clear those girls had.
Was he?
A man.
Have you ever met him?
No. You've never seen him.
Who tells you about him?
He's everywhere.
The story that the girls told police really did center on Slender Man and how they were doing this because they felt like they had to.
And I remember we tried to find Slender Man because Anissa said he could help us.
Remember, police say after they stabbed Peyton 19 times, they were found hours later walking along the interstate toward that make-believe mansion. And tonight we learned how seemingly normal that walk was.
We took turns singing songs to each other. We were surprisingly calm, actually. It was like we hadn't just killed someone.
You guys walked or you guys were running?
We were walking because we didn't want to look suspicious. We were already covered in blood.
They were going to live in this mansion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That they believed existed.
Yeah. Yeah.
How do you even wrap your heads around that?
I can't.
Two parents who must now deal with what's been revealed this week. And tonight, we learn from investigators what they found on the girls' cell phones and on their computers.
There's the number of searches for Slender Man, how to become a proxy, a Google search for how to get away with murdering someone.
We have also learned tonight of an email.
Morgan actually sent an email that said, make sure to delete all your browser history. in your trash, because after this happens, they're definitely going to come and search it.
Tonight, the preliminary hearings are now complete. A judge will now decide in the coming weeks if the girls will be tried as adults on first-degree intentional homicide or something lesser in juvenile court. If convicted as adults, they would face up to 60 years in prison. As juveniles, they could be out by 25. I have asked Peyton's parents what they make of two vastly different fates facing those two girls.
Do you think they should be charged as adults?
For me, it's about making sure Peyton feels safe, and it's about making sure Peyton feels that she can move on with the rest of her life with no fear.
Peyton's story has already started a conversation in so many homes and in classrooms about the fantasy world of Slender Man. Experts say it all started with these two pictures posted on a blog, and then a web series about Slender Man on YouTube, then video games, children playing. And perhaps you'll remember this moment, my visit to a middle school in New York, 900 miles away from Waukesha, Wisconsin, far away from those headlines in that town. Parents here agreed to let us in.
Hi, guys.
They watched and listened on headphones right outside that classroom.
I'm curious, how many of you in the room have heard of Slender Man?
And just listen to all of the different ways that these children, all the same age as Peyton and those girls, discovered Slender Man too. Oh,
I played a game like on the iPad, but he's not real.
So you first found out about Slender Man on Instagram?
I downloaded it on my own.
So you've seen him before?
Well, I've never seen him like in person, but yes, I've seen him.
And we had one last question.
How many of you tell your parents everything you look up on the internet?
And outside in that hallway, the parents.
As parents, we've been thrown to the wild, wild west with the internet and with social media.
A wild west Peyton's family, sadly, was thrown into. And tonight here, one more thing we would discover during our journey with Peyton's family, her brother Caden there getting a kiss from mom. Peyton had actually asked her parents about Slender Man before any of this ever happened.
Morgan had been talking with her about Slender Man, and Peyton was terrified.
Did Peyton know, though, that this was a fictional character?
She was torn because she would say, Morgan knows he's real.
When you heard that Morgan thought that this character was real, did it give you pause?
A little bit, but at the same time, these girls are 12 years old, and fantasy when you're 12 years old is still a very active part of your life.
And just this week in court, evidence of how far some children can be pulled into that fantasy, into an internet character story. Lawyers presenting a hidden trove of twisted drawings found in Morgan's bedroom. Depictions of frightened children with the words, "Help me escape my mind, not even safe in your house." Even dismembered Barbie dolls covered in Slender Man's symbol. Investigators say for Morgan, the fantasy had become real. When we come back tonight, we remember one of the toughest and most telling moments from our interview.
I'm curious, as parents sitting here, and this is, you know, not an easy question to ask.
And you will see the survivor, Peyton, and what's happened in her life just this past week.
Once again, David Muir and more of Out of the Woods.
Tonight, more than 8 months since 12-year-old Peyton crawled out of those woods, the snow, the cold has moved in. But the warm hearts of that community, the bravery of one family, helping to bring Peyton back.
I get down on one knee and just pray for her.
We will never forget Peyton's parents telling me they are grateful those girls didn't strike that first night in the bedroom or the next day in that park bathroom, because they say there would have been no one to help. Instead, they're grateful for that hero who just happened to take that path, finding their little girl.
The fact that he was coming down this way is just unbelievable at that moment. There's too many pieces that saved her life.
We were with them as they thanked him, hugging the man who called 911 for their daughter.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
They're grateful to the paramedics, to the hospital minutes away, to the surgeon who discovered the biggest danger, that one stab wound, just a hair from that artery in her heart.
Everybody did what they had to do at the precise moment to bring her home.
That's how we're seeing it.
And just this past week, Peyton celebrating her 13th birthday, now a teenager.
Uh-oh.
And for that birthday, Peyton headed back.
I know I'm working on
the one place that still makes her smile most, the animal shelter not far from home.
This is a good place to come.
There have been other moments of joy too. The Katy Perry concert she went to, ready to show me her video. All these months later, we have not asked her about those moments in the woods. There is no reason to relive that pain. But her parents have told us from the start, they wanted us to see her smiling again. The smile they feared they lost for good. The smiles we saw looking at her notebooks with kittens all over them before the school year even began.
Observations from a crash.
Some people would say she's doing remarkably well given what's happened to her.
I'm astonished at the way that she's been able to recover.
When we went inside Peyton's room, her walls were covered in purple hearts, Peyton's favorite color. On them, messages from children and from parents all over the world, all of them writing to the survivor who told her parents, "I wanted to live."
This is just a fraction. We've received, I think, over 10,000 hearts and letters. I like this one. "Don't let one act of evil stop you from seeing the beauty in the rest of the world."
Family, friends helping them, perfect strangers, the gifts of food, the help with her medical bills.
This horrific act of violence brought out the very worst in a few people and the very best in thousands of people around the world.
Even an anonymous donor paying for the family's legal representation. They know Peyton could be called upon to face the two girls she thought were her friends in court. What Peyton's parents revealed to me about the other families.
I'm curious, as parents sitting here, and this is, you know, not an easy question to ask, but the parents of the other girls, have you thought about what the other parents are thinking?
I think about the other parents all the time. I can't imagine what they're going through. I can't imagine getting that phone call, hearing these things.
And knowing as it was the person that
knowing
you
it
raised.
Was the person that you loved.
And tonight, from those interrogation tapes, haunting words from Morgan herself.
"I honestly don't know why we did this."
But Peyton's father, instead, choosing to focus on his own daughter, who just turned 13, tonight proving to the world she is truly a survivor.
She's meant to do something special. She's here for a reason, to show the world, to treat other people better, for parents to maybe see, dig in a little deeper about what their children are doing. Maybe she herself is supposed to be an inspiration.
In fact, she already is. Remember the children in that classroom 900 miles away? All of them with a message for Peyton.
"She's really brave and strong. You're a hero. She's amazing. Every day I
fight for." And even though that path where their little girl crawled out through that opening in the woods is now covered with snow, we won't forget the day that her mother and father revealed to me what they told their daughter.
"I told her I thought I lost you. And she said, but you didn't. We knew that she had the strength, but now I think everybody knows it."
"Everybody does know."
"She's an amazing child.
She's definitely our hero." "Sometimes all it takes is one voice. Take what you want.
And now, a look at a special 2020 next week. Diane Sawyer entering a place 174 women go every day, to prison. Next week, Diane puts a face on so many of those women behind bars.
Next Friday, they are a separate nation of women, your neighbors, your friends.
So wake me up when it's all over.
A place where inmates and officers collide.
Can you tell me what was going on here?
Diane Sawyer, inside a world in turmoil, with all your questions about the secrets of prison life.
Come on, Miss Diane, you know I'm not going to say none of that.
Why is America locking up more women than anywhere else in the world? 8 months of reporting, one astonishing hour. The Diane Sawyer 2020 special, next Friday at 10, 9 Central on ABC.
That is a special you will not want to miss. And that is our program for tonight. Thanks so much for watching. Stay warm wherever you are. I'm Elizabeth Vargas.
And I'm David Muir. From all of us here at 2020 and ABC News, have a great evening and a great weekend. Good night.